All right. Welcome, everybody. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Welcome to this evening. I've been so excited about this time that we're about to have with my father, Bishop Donnie Hill, and I'm honored to be able to do this video. Pulled him into my office, brought his saxophone with him, and he's going to play a few songs. We're going to play a song, and then we're going to talk a little bit. And just going to relax. Got my coffee. I hope you relax with us and just take time to watch this video. It's going to be really good, really good. So we're going to start off with a song. Microphone up to you and let's talk a little bit. I hope everybody's doing good. Oh. And man, I enjoyed that whether anybody else did or not.
Have fun. Amen. Have fun. It's a perilous time and you may as well have fun.
May as well have fun with, you know, this is history that we're in, history that we're in that we've never experienced before in our generation, in our lifetimes. And but you know what? I think God's doing greater things than he's ever done
greater,
before.
Greater, greater, greater.
I'm glad you're here, Dad.
You tricked me. I thought you were going to preach. No. I thought we would play one song maybe, and you'd preach about an hour.
Well,
and I was going to amen you.
Yeah, well, amen would have been good.
Audience, but, 6 feet away, I was going to amen you.
No, this is about you. I wanted to make this about you and let people learn who you are a little bit more. Some know you, some don't. And so I've got a few questions I want to ask you, and
Well, questions are easy. It's the answers that's hard.
Well, question number one, when did you start playing the saxophone?
Fourth grade of school. I was in the fourth grade, and I didn't know what to play. They said, do you want to play an instrument? And I did, and I thought I might play a trumpet. My mother thought trumpets make too much loud noise. And then I thought I might play a clarinet. My sister suggested a saxophone. I said, what is a saxophone? And she motioned it out for me. And my mother thought, well, that'd be a nice thing. So we were going to rent one. And in them days, it cost $1 a week to rent an instrument from the music store. But by the time we got there for school band, they'd all rented out, and my mother just bought a new one. Just bought a new one.
Was it a tenor sax?
Alto. Yeah. And I played in the school band every year. And when I was in high school, I started, I was preaching. And I didn't, in those days, if you went to a ball game, you got preached on.
Boy, you couldn't even go to a ball game.
Stay away from them ball games.
Ooh, Lord help them, Jesus.
Oh, they'd let you have it. And, you know, and I'm glad times have changed somewhat.
Glad we can go to a ball game.
We can go to a ball game now. I've been to plenty of them. And, but I did not want to march in the band, on the field. I just didn't want to do that. And I in high school, I dropped out of the band. But I never regretted that. It was something I didn't enjoy. And I didn't want to spend all summer on the football field.
Yeah, yeah.
I was a traveling man, and I knew that'd hold me down.
Yeah. Yeah, I know the feeling. I didn't want to be busy in summer because I was busy in the summer.
Yes, yes.
That's what made you start playing the saxophone, basically. Just kind of almost seemed like it was just a happenstance.
Well, in the third grade, everybody played those little flutes.
Yeah.
Flute of Flown.
Recorder?
Little white eight.
Recorder.
It kind of fingers the same way a saxophone does. It had about the same fingering to it. It wasn't much problem to pick the horn up. And I've always wanted to play other instruments. Yeah. I can thump on a piano. I can thump on a guitar, but I've never been successful with them.
Well, what year, I know there was a church in Middlesboro, Kentucky, the Church God Mountain Assembly in Middlesboro, that helped you purchase the saxophone you're playing now. Do you remember what year that was?
Yes, I do. I had gone from a tenor sax, alto sax, to a tenor, and it was a cheap one. It was not a real good horn. It didn't have a good tone. And in 1968, something happened to that horn. I couldn't reach high keys with that saxophone. It was probably the pads on the keys where they would leak, you know, as you would press them down. And I was in a revival with Pastor Willie Lee Parton.
Yeah.
Pastor. He's gone to heaven now, but I sure miss him. And Willie wanted to hear that horn. They had not heard a saxophone, and he wanted to hear me play. And I said, Willie, it's tore up. I can't play it. And Willie said, we'll just buy you one. I said, I don't think you understand what they cost. He said, I want the top of the line. He said, get the best they got. And that church, along with the leadership of Brother Willie, bought me this horn in 1968.
1968.
Yes.
Wow.
I've had pads put on the keys, I think, twice now in those years.
And, well, that's a Selmer horn, which now, of course, they're made.
Selmer, it was made in Paris.
Yeah, they're made cheaply now for the most part. There's some of them that are still expensive, but that's one of the original
horns. Yes, it is.
Horns,
and it costs a lot of money, especially in that day.
Yeah.
In 68, that was a lot of money.
Yeah.
But there were several people giving me $100 on it, and I was so excited. I couldn't believe it. Mm. And yeah. I've kept this horn ever since. And I didn't think it was all that valuable. I saw a horn in Knoxville, and I just asked the man how could we trade, and he said what will you ask? I said what? He said, well, how much do you need to trade with me? And
so he was willing to offer you money.
He said, I'd be glad to take your horn off your hands. So I kept it.
Yeah. Well, let's play another song, then we'll talk a little bit about your records, when you made them and things.
All right.
What do you want to play this time?
Let's play a fun one.
Okay.
Give me A minor, and we'll play about Joshua. He fits. Joshua fit the band. It's all right to use improper English when you write a song, so we fit the battle.
Yeah.
I need rest between songs.
Yeah, it's all right. Well, we can rest and talk and chat. So somebody actually said on here, it's Janina. She said, the memories are flooding, and it makes me think about, even as a kid, I remember you being on stage with her dad.
Her dad.
Playing
yes.
the guitar and you Otis. Playing the saxophone. And absolutely, what memories.
Was a best friend. He was very instrumental, one of the greatest church members that you could ever ask for. Very faithful.
Yeah.
And a great guy. Helped us build a church on Carter Street.
Yeah, yeah.
And he was always there.
Yeah. He was a good man. I remember him.
Very
he was
well.
A good man. Well, what was the first record you made? Was it a little 45 or was it
a 45, yeah.
yeah.
It had four songs on it and sold them for $1 a piece.
Yeah.
I was evangelizing, and boy, did I need the money. Sometimes, you know, people think, oh, the life of an evangelist. And I did evangelize about 8 years, but you think, oh, the life of an evangelist, this is so glamorous, you know. But if it hadn't been for my dad,
yeah.
sometimes he'd give me money to get from one revival to another.
Yeah.
I sold those for $1 a piece. And
where'd you make them at? Do you remember?
In Cleveland.
Made them in
Ohio,
Cleveland.
Ohio, yeah. There
yeah.
was an organ player that helped me. His name was Norris, Johnny Norris. And there was a drummer that helped me. His name was John as well. No, his name was Jim. I'm sorry. And they just donated their talent.
Mm-hmm.
And that blessed me. That really helped me. You wouldn't think a dollar would be much, but gasoline was about 29 cents.
Boy,
I
wish you'd get back there again today.
Yeah.
Looks like it's going to go the other way, maybe.
Yeah,
I wish it was there today. How many of those 45s? Didn't you make another 45, or was
oh,
it?
Oh no, that's the only one I made.
Only 45 you made. Then you made two other records, right?
Yeah, two albums.
Yeah,
each had 12 songs. One had 10, and one had 12 songs.
Yeah,
and that helped me. That kept me on the road. That made car payments.
Yeah. Well, right behind you there, you could turn around and see I have your records in that case behind you on the ground. But I also found something that I don't know how old you were, but it's band notes that you drew to some song. I've never figured out what song it is, but it was in one of your albums and had your name on it from your school days.
How about that?
That I found.
I used to write music a little bit. Yeah. I enjoyed that.
That's good. What year did you start preaching?
In 64. It's 1964. I was saved on December 22nd, 1963. And I've got a Bible at home that I wrote down in the front of that little Bible when I preached my first sermon.
Yeah.
And I preached... I carried that Bible with me everywhere I went, to school especially. Hmm. I remember in 63 when that Madeline Mary O'Hara was so instrumental in getting prayer taken out of schools.
Yeah.
And I said to myself, nobody is going to stop me from praying.
Hmm.
And the day that law... was placed. I remember went to school and I prayed all day. I prayed. It's a wonder the teachers didn't call me, you know, like I looked like I was probably in space. But I prayed all day, and I purposely prayed that way all day to myself.
Yeah.
I wasn't praying out loud.
Yeah.
But I said, nobody's going to stop me from praying.
Hmm.
And when God saved me in December, we were on Christmas break, and I went back to school, and I had some rough friends. We were rough. And I thought everybody ought to be glad I saved. But they wasn't. They wasn't my friends no more. They just parted away. And
yeah. It's somehow that happens.
But I carried my Bible all through school. I remember in a sophomore class one time, a teacher come and he picked up my Bible, that little one I carried, and he said, "So you've preached your first sermon already." He saw where I had written it in the front. And he said, "What are you?" Not who are you, but what are you? I said, "Oh, I'm a Pentecostal." He said, "Well, now you can't be speaking in tongues." And I said, "You're too late for that. You should have told me so a few days ago. You're too late."
Too late. Well, how many sermons have you preached?
For 8 years straight. I've got them wrote down.
I know you do. You got a book with everything in it.
I've got a briefcase crammed full of them. Notes. For 8 years straight, I preached over 300 sermons a year.
Yeah.
Some 340, 345. Only days I would take off is days I had to. Christmas, Thanksgiving was a hard time for evangelists, and because people love to be with their family, can't blame them.
Right.
But I preached a lot of sermons. And I kept a book of everywhere I went, every revival I was in, a log, a diary.
Yeah.
And I hope maybe one of my kids or grandkids will.
They will.
They'll see them someday and get something out of them.
They will. They will. When did you quit evangelizing? Was that when you went to Kingston to pastor?
Yeah, it was. That was not entirely, because what happened there, that was in 72, August of 72, I moved to Kingston with my oldest boy, DJ. He was four, and he was going to have to go to kindergarten. And so I thought, well, we'll settle down. But I was elected national youth director in 74. So I stayed at Kingston. I was the assistant national youth director from 68 to 74, 6 years. And then in 74, I was elected in August of national youth director, and I started having to travel. And my wife and DJ, they had to stay home a lot because he started school pretty soon after that.
Yeah, yeah. So you were only in Kingston for about 2 years?
About two, from August 72 to December 74, I left the church. And I would have left in August of 74, but we were looking for a pastor.
Yeah,
and I just didn't want to walk away from it.
What made you move to Kingston?
I came here. The pastor's name was Wesley Dupe.
Yeah,
and he wanted to give the church up, and I was here in a 2 week revival, and your mother, I said, what about us taking this church? Wesley was begging every day, will you take this church? Will you pastor this church? And I didn't want to at first, but I kind of fell in love with it. And I asked your mother, Joy, I said, what about us having this church? And she said, no way. We don't want to move here from Indiana. I don't want to move away from my family. But in about 2 days later, she said, you know, I think I would like to be here. I never said another word to her, but it was God telling both of us what to do there.
Yeah.
And so we stayed there till December, and we moved out to where we live now. We bought a little place there and had a mobile home. We moved a mobile home there and built our house in 77.
Yeah, yeah. Well, let's play another song, and we'll talk a little bit about you coming to Courts of Praise and starting when you came to Harriman.
Okay.
What song you going to?
Let's play Peace in the Valley. Let's play it in G.
Neighborhood of G, all right.
Good old gospel G. Thank you. Praise the Lord.
I love it. I love it. I'm remembering that at the church, we had an old upright piano.
Yes.
Set over against the wall. You didn't have it on stage. You had it over against the wall on the side. I remember
yeah,
that.
It saved room, yeah. Space.
Well, at that time, you had those rooms on the side of the stage, so your stage was a whole lot more narrow.
Smaller, yes, it was.
But yeah, I remember that.
And we had to open that up.
I remember seeing people playing, but their back was to the crowd because it was up against the wall there. And just thinking about memories like that. You came to Harriman in 1977. Can you tell us a little bit about how you ended up in Harriman?
Yeah, that was a godly move. In a way, I didn't think at the time, but we were at a fellowship meeting, and there was a man preaching, and he was a good man. And he said, "Oh, I just wish somebody would kick me in the back of the pants and put me in a church." And Reverend Jasper Walden from La Follette Church was pastoring in La Follette, and he was district overseer. Hmm. And I was still national youth director. And Jasper said, let's get him in a church.
Yeah.
And we came here to Harriman, and he agreed, the man agreed, I'll pastor that church. Hmm. And so Brother Walden took money out of the district fund and paid deposits for utilities, and he paid the rent. I'm thinking that he paid 90 days rent, 3 months. In advance, because there was a deposit.
Yeah,
that's what it was. And he paid that deposit, and we had everything set up for this man to come on Sunday and preach in this storefront building here on Main Street in Harriman. And he called my house on Saturday. And I think
the Saturday before that Sunday, you're supposed to open.
Yeah, on that Saturday, he called my house, and he was not a married man at the time that we were putting him in this church. And I think my oldest son, DJ, answered the phone, and he said, "Tell your dad that I have married a wife and cannot come." Like the man in the Bible.
Well, that's a parable, ain't it?
Yeah. He said, "Tell your dad I married a wife. I cannot come." I didn't know what I was going to do, but I said, "Well, we'll be there. Let's go." And we went. It was three of us. And there were two more people come in. And then four. I think we had about eight.
Yeah.
That day. And I just... so used to Sunday night church, I said, "Well, we'll have church tonight." And then in those days, everybody started church at 7.
Yeah, yeah.
And we had church that night, and we had more. We had about 10, I think, that night. And the church just started snowballing. I mean, I was still national youth director, but it was going to be my last year. And we were building a youth camp, and the youth fund from where I got my salary was broke, and that church started supporting me.
Yeah,
and they allowed me to do my job as national director, on especially on building that camp as well. And it snowballed to be what it is today.
Well, yeah.
And you've done great works that I never thought would ever happen.
It's funny where it started from. Accidentally is what we would think.
It but is. It was just an accident. Thing.
Now you was in that storefront building, and then you moved to American Legion building for a little bit. Is that right?
Yeah, we every Monday morning, for some reason, the water would back up in the floor of the church, the building we had
storefront,
rented.
Storefront. Yeah.
And the landlord blamed it on on us.
Yeah.
He said, well, I think you're stopping the toilets up. And there were apartments upstairs, and I think that those people probably were doing all their laundry on the same day. Something. And I don't think we were the fault of it.
Yeah.
And so we moved to the American Legion building, and we were getting ready to build, and we were trying to raise a building fund. And I said, Lord, we can't spend a lot of money on rent. And the man at the Legion building, I cannot remember his name, but he said, to tell you what I'll do, he said, here's a building with utilities, heat and air, lights, everything's furnished. How about $10 a service? So we rented the American Legion building for $10 on Sunday and $10 on Wednesday.
Well, that's all right.
The only thing that we had a problem with, and it wasn't a big problem, we'd have to come in on Sunday morning and put our chairs out because they had square dances on Saturday night.
Yeah. Square dance on Saturday, yeah. Pentecostal dance on Sunday.
That's it.
That's good. What year? I think it was 1981, and the only reason I remember that's because that's the year that I was born.
Yes.
But that you built the building on Carter Street.
We did.
And moved into there. And I can remember that building as a kid being just a block in outside building on the outside. It was a block, and I remember the paneling on the inside.
Yes.
But you talked about Otis, and who else helped you build that building? Most of the work was from the people of the church, right?
The No family from Oliver Springs.
Yeah.
Don, Jerry. Larry was the oldest brother. There were three brothers. And Larry was very instrumental. I don't know what we'd have done without Larry helping us. Their dad, David No.
Yeah.
David and his nephew laid the block for that church. We paid them, but they did it at a very low cost.
Yeah.
I know it was the bare minimum that they worked. And it just happened that they were, both of them were out of work at that time anyway. And they did a great job building that church. We saved a lot of money on labor.
Yeah.
And we're able to put it into that project.
I'm thankful because we've done a lot of work. You know, when we moved here, there's a lot of work that had to be done. And so grateful for people in the church that would step up and work for free or for real cheap.
You never forget that.
You know, and certainly.
And God will reward them.
Yeah, certainly always good because it's their church. It's your church. It's our church. You know, it's not just a pastor's church. It's the entirety of the body. It's their church.
We laid that Brother Otis and Larry, and myself, we put the floor down one night because the block layers had to have the floor down so they could move their scaffolding in. Because the walls were so high, and we subfloored planks, just 1x8s, 1x6s, 1x8s, pine planks, and we nailed way up in the morning. I think we quit about 2 a.m. We come back working on the building the next day, and one of the neighbors came up and he said, y'all are not going to work all night again tonight, are you? We heard you hammering, three hammers going, driving nails. I guess we disturbed the neighborhood.
I guess probably so, yeah. So you came in 77, built that building in 81, and do you remember about how many people you had when you built that building?
Probably 40, 45, something like that.
Yeah.
We grew fast.
Now, I also remember, was there a house that sat on the property the actual church is on?
Yes.
So you had to tear that house down.
Yeah. We contracted.
So there was two houses and that filling station on that corner lot.
That's right. There were two houses and a filling station. We tore the old house down, moved it away. Some people that tore houses, they did that for their living.
Yeah.
And we gave them whatever they wanted.
Right, yeah.
And they tore it down, and we built right on that spot.
Now, there's not many people going to know this, and I don't know if you know much about it, but I've always heard people talk about it. Was there a cab service, a taxi service
right
in that area,
too? Used to be a cab service there, Bodine's cab service.
Was that right there in that lot,
right
too?
On that lot, yeah.
Yeah.
It where the alley comes into the parking lot.
You got to be back in the day to know,
Bodine's
to remember
Bodine's cab service was on the curb there.
Yeah.
And a lot of people may not know this, but that used to be U.S. Highway 27.
That went Emory Street.
Yes.
Yeah, that went right around the side there.
Yep.
Because that other bridge wasn't there, right?
Right.
The bridge that goes by.
The old bridge was there, but the new bridge in Harriman that goes through Harriman.
Yeah.
Where 27 is now was not, it did not exist.
So the actual bridge, though, was the bridge that crosses over Riverfront Park.
Yeah, yeah.
That's the bridge everybody come across.
That was it. That was U.S. 27.
Hmm.
Yes. That was a busy corner at one time.
Yeah. Well, it's still pretty busy today, I've noticed, mm-hmm. especially with the park there and everything. Yeah, so you tore that house down. I do still remember the house beside it, and I remember that old filling station, which it wasn't a filling station at the time. It was more of a junkyard.
Yes,
a
it
garage,
was.
Like a garage.
Yeah.
When I remember it. But
had junk cars all around it.
Yeah. God bless. You guys bought the house first, didn't you?
We bought that old house.
Tore it down and made it a parking lot.
Yeah. And then our next project was to buy that house next door.
Yeah.
A lady named Sally Hill, I think, owned that. And she wasn't any kin to us. And she moved to Nashville.
Yeah.
And had to sell away.
And then you bought the corner filling station, Triangle.
Right.
Filling station there
right.
on the corner.
That was called Triangle Shell.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I thought the name Triangle, I thought that's what it was. I just couldn't remember for sure. Yeah. And then there was an old apartment building that used to be, I think, a dentist office. Wasn't it a dentist office or a doctor's office?
Across
at
the
one
street.
Time? Across the
there
street.
There was a doctor's office
doctor's
there.
Doctor's office, yeah.
Yeah. And it was.
And they had made apartments
apartment
in
building
it.
Building out of it, too.
Yeah. Yeah. He bought that whole lot and tore that place down.
Yes.
And, so God really blessed while you was there.
Yes.
Always did. God always provided.
Always.
Thank God for that. Let's play another song.
All right. I'm trying to think what we ought to play. Let's play When the Saints March In.
When the Saints Go Marching In.
Holiness G.
Was always one of my favorite songs. I actually did my very best to mimic it on the saxophone. However, it just never sounded quite the same.
Well, I'm a little out of breath. I'm a little out of practice.
Well, that sounded good to me. That song's on your record. Every song you've done tonight's been on the records that you made through the years. And, I know there's probably a lot of people that still have those records. I meet somebody every so often that says, I have a record of your dad.
They do,
They're throughout the churches that we know and things like that. So many years. So how old were you when you preached your first sermon, 15 or 16?
Yes, I was.
He's 15.
15 years old. And I preached it. I was probably, I think it was sometime in April that I preached my first sermon.
Do you remember what it was on?
No, I don't. I don't remember.
Yeah.
I could look it up, I think. Probably
got it wrote down. Yeah.
I tried to write everything down. And you and I made a CD. And you ought to make some copies. I get a lot of requests.
Yeah, we did that, and
they like to hear your
I would have to start digging and try to find it. It's somewhere out there, somewhere
make
around.
Make some copies. Yeah, we sold them all.
Yeah. We may just need to make another one, and maybe we start if we start now. We can make a Christmas album.
We might
and have it ready for
we
Christmas.
Might. I might have it if we did one song a month. I might could make it.
Well, I want to talk just a little bit more about your ministry, and then we'll do one more song and close everything out. I have a question that give to you. If you could go back to the beginning at age 15, would you do it all again?
Yeah. I would. I thought about that. It's funny you ask that. I was driving somewhere a few days ago, and I asked myself that question: would I do it again? And I think I would. I don't regret anything. I know we've all got hindsight, and I have made more mistakes than I can count, and blunders, and I can't undo them. They're mistakes that I can't undo, but I don't know why I wouldn't do it again. If anything, I'd get more involved.
That was my second question. If you could change anything, would you change anything?
I'd be more aggressive about what I have done. Yeah, God. I know we can all look back and say, boy, I missed the corner on that one, or I should have made this deal, or I should have taken this job or something. I don't know of anything that I'd rather do. Church of God Mountain Assembly has been good to me. I don't know of another organization where a young person could advance and do well as he can in this organization, and God's just good to us.
Yeah. Well, another question here. Have you ever wanted to quit?
Never, ever. I thought about it one time. I thought, well, am I doing any good? I came to be so discouraged. It was a time that I was evangelizing. And the revivals were there. I usually stayed booked about 18 months in advance. And in those days, revivals were plentiful. A lot of pastors would say, if you're coming, come 2 weeks. Don't come. You just get started in a week. Come for 2 weeks. And sometimes we'd go 3 weeks. But there was a period of time, I think it was a test, when I look back on it. But it appeared nobody wanted to pray in the altar. Nobody wanted to get saved. I felt like I was not doing anything, not getting any results. And a friend came to me and said, I noticed you appear to be awfully discouraged lately. Is there a problem? Is there something wrong? Something I can help you with. And I said, I don't know. I'm just discouraged. But we hit a revival and God started blessing and folks started pouring in, and from then on it just happened that it was a good thing.
Yeah.
I don't know. I remember that period of time in my life. It lasted 5-6 months maybe.
Hmm.
If I would have quit, it would have been then. But
what do you think it was that kept you going?
I think it was commitment to God.
Yeah.
I didn't want to backslide. I didn't want to go to hell. I got saved because I didn't want to go to hell. But I found a great sermon in 5th chapter of Romans where Paul said, and not only so.
Yeah.
But this ain't all. You know, there's more to this, you
right.
know. And I found there's a lot more to being a Christian than just escaping hell.
Yeah, yeah, that's good. Which do you like better, pastoring or evangelizing?
I love evangelizing, but I'm at my age. I'm just a rusty bucket
preacher.
Well,
looking back over, which did you like better, you think?
I liked evangelizing.
Yeah.
I loved it. You didn't have the problems that pastors do. You just preach, then leave them with it.
Yeah, that's always nice.
And let them have it.
That's always nice unless you're the pastor.
Yeah, you're gone. But if you're the pastor now, he dreads it.
Yeah. I always enjoyed evangelizing. I enjoyed being on the road. But ultimately, I think when it always come down to, I love pastoring better. I like being home and being with my people and watching them grow. I remember my first church in Oliver Springs. I remember seeing a lady came in, she got saved, and little by little she started lifting her hands and worshiping God, an older lady that just never done anything like that before. And just seeing that, I enjoyed seeing the growth in people.
I wondered about that a lot. When I was on the road traveling,
we
had just a little camping trailer and we pulled it. But I wondered a lot about that. What would it be like to have a home where you could go home every night?
Yeah.
You know, and you wouldn't have to worry about traveling all the time. And I did think about that a lot.
Yeah. That was a pretty small trailer you had too, wasn't it?
Very small.
Did
First
you pull
one
it with
I
your Volkswagen?
Was, the first trailer I had was a little bitty 12-footer.
Woo.
Had an ice box, didn't have a refrigerator, no restroom, nothing in it. But
what would you do, just park by the church?
Yes, I parked in the church. I parked at the church lot.
Yeah.
Sometimes I would park at a pastor's house.
Yeah.
But most of the time at the church.
Yeah. I remember we had an old one there. I guess you had used it, but it was old, and I remember the sink. It was one of them pump sinks.
Yeah.
You had to pump the water out of the tank to
sure
get
it
coming to the sink.
It didn't have a pressure tank. You had to pump it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Held 5 gallon water at a time.
Ooh.
And I'd usually take a shower or something in the church.
Yeah, yeah.
The churches had...
most of them had places like that at that time, didn't they?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I remember one time preaching 2 weeks in Toledo, and it never got up to the last day of that meeting, it got up to zero.
Mm.
And every night,
up to zero.
When we'd go to church, well, inside a camper, when you've got the heat on, they get moisture, especially around the doors and windows, and condensation. And every night while we'd be at church, the door would freeze shut. And we'd have to take a little torch and run around the door, the side of the door, to get the door open.
To get the door open.
Yeah.
Well, I'm not going to tell on you what you told on yourself about the torch and
that was could have got my head blown out. That God
the torch
came
and the
to
propane tanks
there.
That's all I'm saying.
God came to my rescue.
Let's play one more
that's
song.
One time God winked at ignorance.
Yeah. Thank God for his mercy.
Let's play one of those old Redbacks.
All right.
And we put this on the CD, Meeting in the Air.
Yeah. Is that key of C?
G. Holiness G.
All right. Thank you all so much for joining us tonight, and just really enjoyed this video. Challenge you just to go back and watch it again and get all this history of Bishop Donnie Hill. We just want to honor him and everything God's done through his life. And I know many probably will see this, that his life has impacted in some way and somehow. So if that is the case, I challenge you, if you got his phone number, I'm not going to give it out, but if you got his phone number, message him, call him, let him know you appreciate him. Put it in the comments, and we'll make sure that he sees them here on the YouTube channel. We love you. Thank you so much for joining us again tonight. We love you. Thank you. God bless you.
Amen.